The country will soon pass another grim number, 700,000 Americans who have died from COVID and related complications. The best way to stop the spread and prevent infection are vaccines, of course. But throughout the pandemic, there have not been many helpful or easy treatment options once people become infected. Now, as William Brangham reports, a new antiviral drug from Merck offers hope for keeping patients with COVID-19 out of the hospital and alive.
That's right, Judy. The only information we have about this drug comes from Merck itself. Federal regulators and regulators abroad haven't seen any of their data. But an independent board reviewing the drug's initial trial said it should be stopped early because results were so promising. The company is now seeking approval for widespread use. To understand how this might help fight the pandemic, I'm joined again by Dr. Nahid Bhadelia. She's an infectious disease specialist at Boston University School of Medicine, where she runs the Center for Emerging Infectious Diseases Policy and Research. Dr. Bhadelia, great to have you back on the NewsHour. What do you make of this drug? Is this a possible new tool for us?
Well, William, if the data pans out, an oral antiviral has been the missing piece in the way that we respond to this pandemic. And the reason it's important is because currently the data that's presented by this press release, which of course we need to validate, shows that if given in the first 5 days of illness, it can reduce hospitalizations and deaths by 50% in people who at least have one medical condition. The difference, though, is compared to monoclonal antibodies, this is something that you can take by mouth. And the use of monoclonals has been limited is because it requires intravenous infusion, and that requires a clinic. If you can give something by mouth quickly after diagnosis, you're improving the access of the drug to more people. You're keeping more people from getting into the hospitals, and you may also reduce the time that people are contagious, which could reduce transmission as well. So a lot of promise there, although the one thing that I will say is that it needs to be linked with testing. We're limited a bit on the way that we test, and you have to have confirmed COVID-19 to then qualify to take this pill. But right now, rapid tests, we're still being plagued by shortages in many parts of the world, as well as in this country.
Right. You can't give the drug to people who are infected if you can't figure out who's actually infected. So it's easier to use. You don't need to do it in a hospital. It's in a pill form. Sounds like you don't need to refrigerate it or any of those concerns like we have with the vaccines. Are there other challenges? I mean, do you have a sense of how quickly this might be manufactured and distributed? Again, if it gets approved.
I think that we would have to hear from the manufacturer about their capacity, right? This is a couple of good things about this drug as well as potential caveats. So I'll start with the caveats. One is it's not a replacement for vaccines because it's always going to be better for you not to get infected. You know, this is a drug that you would get if you ended up getting, unfortunately, a breakthrough infection, or if you're in an under-vaccinated area, which are seeing, of course, high rates of hospitalizations, it'll make a big impact. In terms of manufacturing, Merck would have to create enough of this drug, right? Not just to have an impact here, but hopefully that there could be some effort to produce enough of it to also be distributed to parts of the world where vaccines are not available more readily and where healthcare systems are getting overwhelmed with the appearance of every new variant of this virus.
So can you explain how that works? If ideally we get vaccines to every nation and every population that wants them, but prior to that, you're sort of describing this as a kind of a bridge until vaccines get out there. How does this compare to what a vaccine does as far as its effect on your body?
This is a drug, an antiviral, that stops the replication of the virus by introducing errors when the virus tries to copy itself, right? And in some ways, this is similar to some of the HIV drugs that are on the market that do the same kind of work. It's a different type of technology than some of the messenger RNA vaccines that require specialized production. And hopefully, you know, the barriers to manufacturing this in multiple places may be less because it is technology that could be known. They're a bridge potentially to get to places that haven't been vaccinated enough, but they might also be a bridge, William, if, for example, because of the way that they work, the antivirals might be a bit more resilient against new variants. So let's say a new variant appears on the scene, these drugs may actually be a bridge until we can have a beat to update the vaccine to have them address the variants a bit better.
I know you are an infectious disease scientist, but I'm going to ask you a social science question as well. And every time we've seen a new treatment that comes out in this country, we've seen such divergent reactions to it. We have this safe, effective vaccine that millions of people are suspect about, and yet those same people sometimes will embrace untested, unproven treatments for COVID-19. Let's just say this drug gets approved. Do you have any sense of whether or not this would be embraced by people, or whether this would be the subject of further conspiracy theories?
Well, I think disinformation and misinformation are a challenge that are unfortunately here to stay. And, you know, and I would not be surprised if there was some amount of misinformation, disinformation around these drugs as well. I think what hurts us is when those, you know, disinformation and misinformation pieces actually get amplified by larger media platforms around certain drugs or vaccines, which is what you saw with these highly effective vaccines. So I'm holding out my pessimism potentially that even despite having a potential antiviral that is available, that we may see scenarios where people just don't take them because they get politicized. And I really hope we don't see that.
Well, let's hope when we see the data that there's actually some good news. Nice to occasionally be able to report that. Dr. Nahid Bhadelia, always good to see you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.